Cause it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
Well, hi there. My name is Jim Swanson. You might know me from Blossom Valley Bible Church. And I am here today for a very, very special reason. We have a little interview that we are going to do with one of our dear church members, Mr. George Garcia. Mr. George Garcia, Pastor George, goes by a variety of names. If you're lucky enough, he'll let you call him George. Anyway, I'm here to do a little interview. We're going to hear about George's story, what it was like growing up before Christ and without Christ, what it was like receiving Christ, and what his life is like now. So, without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. George Garcia. Say hi to the camera, George. Wave.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen.
So, we're going to start in the beginning, George. People tell me that's a good place to start. So why don't we start with a little bit about your background, George? Can you tell me when and where you were born, for example?
I was born August 18th, 1949 in San Jose, California.
Hey, can you tell me a little bit about your family? You know, your mom and dad. Did you have any brothers or sisters, George?
Had five brothers and sisters. Mom and dad, there was eight of us in the family. It was a small house with two elm trees out front. And I shared a bedroom with two brothers. In fact, our bedroom was so small, I had to go outside to change my mind.
Wow. that is a small room. Well, three growing boys in one room. It's a wonder you made it as far as you did, George. But do you have any, you know, particular memories of growing up? What made you happy as a kid, man? Did you play sports? Did you watch TV?
Well, Jim, I remember Mom and Dad would have some playful arguing going on. My mom was a Democrat.
Oh, boy.
My dad was a Republican. My mom was a Dodger fan. My dad was a Giants fan, and so there would be banter going around in the house. And wow. I remember memories of playing games with my brothers and sisters in the backyard or maybe in the front yard. We had a good family. We were lower middle class.
Okay.
But we didn't know any better. Mm-hmm. We always had enough to eat. I don't remember seconds,
right?
But I remember we always had enough to eat. We had clothes to wear, and Mom and Dad would have guidelines for us to live by. And so if we stepped out of line in those days,
right,
we would get spanked.
Oh yeah. So did you play any sports? Was there anything that you really stuck out that you like to do?
Well, yes, Pastor Jim. I played Little League baseball.
Spartan Little League?
No,
okay.
No. The north side of San Jose.
Gotcha.
I played 2 years of Little League. Later on, I went into the senior league, which was 13 to 15. In high school, I ran track and I played basketball. In fact, our basketball team in high school went undefeated.
Excellent.
And we beat one team, Pioneer High School, 112-40 in one game.
Oh, my
gosh. With one of our players scoring 45 points.
Well, I have to tell you, George, because I grew up in this area. I'm glad that game wasn't against Andrew Hill.
We did play Andrew Hill twice, and we beat him both times.
So, and what high school did you go to again, George?
San Jose High.
San Jose High. Did you do any work other than homework when you were a kid? Did you get any of those, like, the teenager kind of jobs?
Well, preteen, I had a paper route when I was 10 and 11 years old and made $40 a month. but had to get up
yeah.
and be folding my papers around 5 o'clock in the morning, 7 days a week. And as I said, I would get $40 a month, but it was difficult.
Right.
I did some field work to make a few extra bucks. In fact, I had a job where I made of like 50 cents an hour.
Right.
And picking prunes, apricots, you name it.
Yeah.
I did.
I remember that as a kid. That was the guaranteed summer job for a lot of us kids that got to grow up here during those times. And now there's not even a single prune orchard left.
No. This was in the Evergreen area.
Yeah. So sad. They're all gone now. So you graduated in 67, George?
1967.
1967. Oh boy, that's the summer of love, man. What was it like graduating from high school and going out into the summer of love?
Well, you know, Jim, when I was in junior high, I did well in my studies. I was, you know, a little above average. Once I got to high school, things began to go downhill a little. And in 1967, yeah. I really started cutting classes a lot and hanging around with some friends that maybe weren't the best influence in my life.
Right.
And towards the end of my senior year, I started experimenting with drinking beer, a little wine, and my grades began to go really downhill. In fact, in order to graduate, I had to go to night school, two classes, plus day school. It was so embarrassing, but I graduated.
Yeah, by the skin of your teeth,
by
it sounds like.
By the skin of my teeth, my like parents weren't very happy with that.
Yeah, but so as you graduated and you get a little bit of time off, and you know, as I said earlier, it was called the summer of love. Did you get caught up in any of that hippie stuff, that alternate lifestyle hippie movement that was going on?
Unfortunately, Jim, I did. I graduated 1967, June. Late June, I smoked marijuana for my first time. And later on in the year, I actually used LSD for my first time. And I started using drugs just for the sensation of being high.
Right.
And there was also a lot of rock and roll music in the area. In San Jose, we had the Civic Auditorium, and a lot of the English groups would play there. I had a chance to see The Who, The Yardbirds, The Animals, groups like that. And we also had San Francisco, the Fillmore Auditorium, right. Winterland. And so I really got caught up in a lot of that. I began to let my hair grow and wear the faded Levi's
right.
and all that. And I got caught up in it.
So did you wait long? Because I know that you went to City College for a while. Did you go immediately after that summer was over? Did you start right into City College that fall?
I started shortly after. I can't even be sure. It's been so long.
Yeah.
But I did attend San Jose City
okay.
College. But just like in high school, I began to miss a lot of classes.
Mm-hmm.
And I was using a lot of drugs. And I really thought that I was enjoying the best the world had to offer, and little did I know, it was really enslaving me. And eventually I dropped out of San Jose City College because I just was not attending classes.
Right. What year would this have been, George, when you dropped out?
This was early 69, I think it was.
Oh, okay. Wow, that must have been scary because now you're no longer in school, so you're not getting the draft deferment.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
It could have been late 68. I'm not sure.
Okay.
But I did get one. I got a greetings letter.
They caught you.
From Uncle Sam.
Oh, my gosh. So when did that happen, George? When did you get that letter?
Well, I got the letter in 1969, and at that time, I was going to a lot of anti-war rallies and listening to a lot of anti-war speech, and I had some friends that were a little older than me, and they were presenting their views, and I truly became convinced that the Vietnam War, our involvement in the war, was wrong.
Right.
And kind of kept it to myself. At the rallies, I would see the flag desecrated and things like that. I didn't agree with that. I believed in our flag, but some people were really getting pretty rowdy about it.
Right.
And yet, I was a part of that group.
Yeah. So that would have been the summer of 1969 then, and you get your letter from Uncle Sam, huh?
I got my letter from Uncle Sam, and it said to report July 31st to Oakland, and I would get a physical.
Yeah. The AFI Center in Oakland. Been there. I've been there. So I know all about that.
Been there and done that.
Yes, sir. So Uncle Sam invites you to join him, huh? For a while. How was that experience, George? What was it like for a counterculture, long-haired kind of guy to all of a sudden, in the blink of an eye, be in the military? What was that experience like?
Well, Jim, I was getting an allergic reaction to some soaps. And so I got a doctor's letter saying that I was allergic to some soaps and stuff. And so I went to Oakland July 31st. And I was so naive, I really thought that I had a good chance of being exempted from the service. Well, it didn't work. They stamped approved.
Right.
So now I had to make a decision. So while guys are going into the room to raise their right hand and take the oath, I was outside. And I got into a conversation with a military individual in uniform. I don't remember what branch of the service he was in. But he told me, he says, you know, George, if you go to Fort Lewis with the others and tell them your views, in 2 or 3 months you'll be out. Well, that wasn't true.
No.
So I signed the paperwork. Mm-hmm. I didn't go in the room and raise my right hand, but I signed the paperwork. So technically,
right.
I'm in the service.
Right.
And off to Fort Lewis I go.
Okay.
And that was the beginning of, for me, which was a nightmare. Once I landed Fort Lewis, we're all put into these lines and have to stand maybe kind of like at attention, and I raise my right hand, excuse me, I have something, get back in line. So by the time I explained my views, it wasn't really going anywhere. So for 5 months, I actually went through 2.5 cycles of basic training. The group I went in originally, it was 8 weeks. They graduated, I stayed behind. Another 8-week group came in and I joined them, and who's this weirdo? And they graduated, and
right.
then half of a third cycle. The first group, there were 3 guys I went to San Jose High School with.
Is that right? Yeah.
Once we got to Fort Lewis, and I had a few conversations with some people, the soldiers were told to stay away from Garcia. He's going to try to indoctrinate you in this anti-war stuff. And so the 3 guys I actually went to San Jose High with, one of them I played on the basketball team with, wouldn't talk to me. And it got so bad, I was on the verge of having a breakdown. So along with another soldier, we went AWOL. Wound up in Portland, Oregon, met some anti-war guy there, and we told him we were AWOL, and he gave us the keys to his place in Eugene, Oregon.
Okay.
And we went there, and I stayed there for a week, realizing this wasn't helping me. And so I went back and got rode up for that. Anyway, my company commander had given me a couple of times orders to pick up a weapon and go train with the others. So in November, sometime in November, he called me in for the last time into his office, and he gave me a direct order, called the first sergeant in to be a witness, told me, Private Garcia, I'm giving you a direct order to pick up a weapon and go and train. And I rejected it. So he told the first sergeant, start drawing up the paperwork. We're gonna get Garcia court-martialed. And so in January of 1970, January 5th, I think it was, I went for my court-martial hearing. They asked me to get someone who knew me better than anybody as a character reference, and that would be my mother. So my mother flew up there, and she attended my court-martial, and they called her to the stand, and she testified that she had trained her children to stand up for their convictions. When they felt something was right, to actually be willing to follow it to the end if necessary. And so she pleaded with the judge while on the stand in her blue dress with white polka dots, saying, put me in prison. I'm the one that instilled in my son to stand up for his convictions. And she's pleading with a judge, and she's sobbing, and I'm sitting there watching my mother, unlike any time I'd ever seen her before, the love of a mother. And unfortunately, she wasn't able to sway
right.
them.
Right.
And so I was given a 3-year prison sentence, forfeiture of all pay and allowances, and a dishonorable discharge.
Oh, my. So that was on, that would have been, you said in January?
That was January 5th.
Okay.
What happened then, Jim, Pastor Jim, was I went immediately to the stockade. And the stockade's like the county jail.
Right.
It's a
right.
bad place.
Oh, yes.
Bad place, and there's short timers there, people with a few months.
You're right.
And a lot of fights, a lot of people trying to, you know, find out if you're tough enough or not.
Sure.
And it was no picnic there.
Right.
Sometime in March, early April, they shipped two or three of us to Fort Leavenworth in Kansas. And that's where I finished the rest of my time. So we pull up in a van, and here's this prison with these huge stone walls with guard towers and stuff.
Right.
And the prison cells were looked exactly like they do on Alcatraz. I did an Alcatraz tour.
Uh-huh.
And the prison cells looked exactly like that. And I couldn't believe I was there, because I'd never been in any trouble before with the law.
Right.
But as my mother would say, son, if you make your bed, you have to be ready to sleep in it.
Yeah.
I made a decision to reject a direct order, and so now I'm at Fort Leavenworth.
Oh, my. That's, I mean, for any of you who don't know, Fort Leavenworth is legendary for being one of the least hospitable places on the face of the earth. And here you are stuck right in the middle of it, George. Right in the middle of it. And they gave you a 3-year sentence, man?
I was given a 3-year sentence, yes.
Oh my gosh. Well, what happened with that? Were you there for 3 years?
Well, Pastor Jim, I got there, and within a month or two, I had a hearing, as all the inmates do,
right,
with a military board of the six officers or so in a semicircle, and you're sitting there facing them, terrifying.
Yeah.
And the result was my sentence was cut to 2.5 years, and from a dishonorable to a bad conduct, which is the second worst,
yeah,
but it's still a bad thing.
Right, right.
And so, pulled a lot of KP, kitchen patrol, and
yep,
washed a lot of pots and pans, and 4 o'clock in the morning till about 9:30 at night, every other day for a while. And I'm in a one-man cell, very small cell, and I just can't believe that I'm there. Was receiving some mail from family and friends, and but I just could not believe that I was actually there. I had another hearing, and I made B custody, so I moved out of a one-man cell to like a 20-man dorm type thing.
Right.
But that's when trouble really started, because on the floor I was on, there was like 3 or 4 of those 20-man dorms, and the inmates are able to sneak around.
Right.
So one night, over a misunderstanding, they told me to meet them in the library, some of the inmates, that I had done something, and I fell for it. And I wound up getting a beating, got my ribs kicked in pretty good. And I started screaming, "Guard, guard." Had 2 guards on the floor. The inmates scattered. They came, rescued me, took me to their office, and they wanted to know who had beaten me.
Right.
Well, I wouldn't tell them, because if I told them, life would be a lot rougher there for me.
Exactly.
So I told them, "I can't tell you who beat me."
Yeah.
So anyway, every day was an adventure. And Pastor Jim, what happened then was I had another hearing, and I didn't know what the results were, but then I found out that I was going from B custody to A custody, which was outside of the walls on like a little ranch, a little farm.
Mm-hmm.
And there were no fences or anything. You can escape, but if you did and they catch you, they'd add more time to you.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm working in a nursery, and I'm also delivering cords of firewood to civilians there. And we had our own washer and dryer, the inmates, and we were washing our own clothes. They didn't open your mail. And so people were getting marijuana smuggled in.
Oh my.
So we're smoking marijuana while in prison. And I'm working in the nursery, and on December 12th of that year, 1970, I was called into the supervisor's office, and he's military, he's a sergeant, and there's a few inmates in the office too. And he had some paperwork, and he said, "Private Garcia, you're getting out in 10 days. And I said, "Sarge, don't play around like that." And he gave me the paperwork, and I'm reading it like this, and the words
right,
are jumping all over, and I'm crying, and I'm reading it. And that's December 12th. So I actually got out December 22nd of 1970. Was able to call my older brother in San Jose, tell him that I'll be getting out, and he was to meet me at the San Francisco airport.
Wow.
And I would be there roughly a little before 12 on the 22nd. So on December 22nd, I walk out of the prison, go to some airport, I don't know where it was at,
yeah,
get on an airplane, and I'm flying to San Francisco, not knowing any better. I tell the guy next to me, "I just got out of prison."
Oh.
So we strike up a conversation,
right?
And yeah, I'm telling him about what I've just gone through. And land in San Francisco, 11 something. And by the time I meet up with my brother and his friend Ron Neal, it's after midnight, so now it's the 23rd.
Okay.
And I was gonna spend the night, my plan was to spend the night at my brother's house because I didn't tell my parents.
Oh, you're gonna surprise
them. That I had been paroled.
You're gonna surprise them.
And I was gonna surprise them.
Oh, man.
But as we're driving to my brother's house, I told him, you know what, Frank? Let's go to Mom and Dad's.
Yeah.
I gotta see him.
Of course, of course.
So there was a change in plans. We get to my parents' house, my house, and I'm ringing the doorbell, and I hear my dad yelling, cussing, who?
Sure.
So the door opens, and there I am with my brother Frank and Ron Neal. Man. My mom screams, opens the door.
Oh my God.
Gives me a back-breaking hug. My dad does too. Now my dad had served in World War II. So he was a little upset with me.
Right.
But he was happy that day.
Absolutely. Well, I think there's a story in the Bible, something like that, right? Where the son comes back. I remember something along those lines. So it must have felt good to be out. I know that it felt good to be out. But how did that experience change you? You know, George, a lot of people go into that kind of a situation and they end up bitter. Did you, were you a bitter guy, or do you think that it may have made you a better man?
Jim, a little of both. I was better in that the discipline of prison and army life that I had really was good and did instill in me some good habits.
Right.
But I was a very bitter young man in that I felt that prior to the court-martial and the time that I served, which was 11 months, 15 days, roughly 17 months, I felt that I had been robbed, which was incorrect. I had made my decision.
Sure.
So now I wanted to make up for lost time. So again, I let my hair begin to grow, and eventually it got down to almost my belt. And I was really using a lot of LSD and marijuana and cocaine and stuff like that. And my life was really spinning out of control.
Is that right? Oh, man. Well, something must have happened, George, because I know for a fact that if you had continued on that path, we probably wouldn't be talking right now, because you'd have probably been dead. So can you tell me what happened? What put the brakes on that spinning out of control?
Jim, in a nutshell, the group that I was hanging around with, it was involved in the same lifestyle I was. There was a young man in there by the name of Rudy. And I'd known Rudy since we were 10, 11 years old. And we both got involved in the drug lifestyle. But what I didn't know was that Rudy had a background in the church as a young man.
Okay.
We call it backslidden.
Right.
And Rudy was backslidden. And he disappeared from our group for a while. We didn't really know what had happened to him. And we would be partying and go to San Francisco to the Fillmore and all that. And Rudy was no longer going with us. And one day at a party, Rudy shows up, and he still has some longish hair, but it's trimmed now and he's dressing different.
Right.
And now he's beginning to talk to us about Jesus Christ. And I'm thinking, what? Because I had been raised in the church too.
Right.
But none of it stuck. So one day he's talking to him about Jesus and what Jesus had done for him and what Jesus could do for me. And this is at a party. And so I took a hit or drag up a marijuana cigarette and blew it in his face. And I'm laughing, and the others began to laugh at him too. And he looks at us and he just smiles and says, "I'll see you." And he left. A week or two later at another party, he shows up again. And he's talking to me about God.
Yeah.
And wanting to look good in front of my friends and show off. I tore open a can of malt liquor and I told him, "This is my God." And I drank it. And out of the corner of my eye, I could see a tear come down his face. And he said goodbye to everybody. He knew everybody. And he left. A week or two later, he comes back again. He leaves. He did it like 8 to 10 times. No matter what we did to him, he kept coming back. So one day, March 21st, 1973, I'm living in a Victorian house cut into four apartments.
Right. Like downtown San Jose?
Downtown San Jose on Fifth Street.
Right.
And Rudy's living and his wife are living down below. And he's involved in the church. And one night a week, he has a few little junior hires come over to his apartment.
Yeah.
And he's teaching them. And I'm upstairs doing drugs and stuff.
Right.
Little did I know, that little junior high group was praying for me.
Wow.
Praying for the guy upstairs.
Yeah.
And on March 21st, 1973, right before I went to work, because I had to have a job to get out of prison and I'm working at a furniture store.
Right.
Rudy comes up to my apartment and he's talking to me now about Jesus Christ, and this time I'm receptive. And I told him, "You know what? In front of everyone else, I put on a front. But I'm really a miserable guy and I'm unhappy and I know I'm on my way to hell. I do believe in a hell and a heaven. I know I'm going to hell, and I don't want to go there." So he started sharing with me truths from the Bible, and this time he's getting through. He told me, "If you know the right thing to do and you don't do it, that's a sin."
Amen.
"But if you do bad things against the laws of God, that's a sin too."
Amen.
So God has you boxed in any way you look at it. But Jesus Christ came and he paid the sin debt that we could not pay. There's not a human being on earth that could pay their sin debt. Jesus died on Calvary's cross, paying the penalty for the whole world. But it's only good if you put your trust in Jesus.
Amen.
You have to personally receive him. And this time he's getting through to me. He said, "George, I'll tell you what, I'm going to kneel right here in your apartment and you kneel over there. I'm going to say a prayer and you repeat it after me. But the important thing, George, is that you mean that prayer.
Right.
If you mean that prayer, God will honor your prayer. He'll forgive you of all your sins, past, present, future. He'll make you a child of God, and you'll inherit eternal life." And I'm thinking, wow. So he said the prayer. I had never, ever cried in front of any of my friends. You know, I didn't want to be a sissy.
Right.
But as I'm saying the prayer, in my apartment on Fifth Street, I began to sob. I get the prayer out. He hugs me and he says, "What we're gonna do is once a week, we're gonna get together and I'm gonna teach you some Bible."
Yeah.
And he began to, what we call, disciple me. And he goes, "You need to be a part of a church." So he took me to First Baptist Church on the Hill, 800 Ironwood Drive, and I attended there for 2 years.
Yes.
And from there, the rest is history.
Yeah. That was, what, 47 and almost 48 years ago, George. What has your life been since that day? What's it been like walking with Jesus for 47, almost 48 years?
Well, like every newborn baby, the first year or two, I would make a little mess here and there.
Sure.
Yeah. And maybe my vocabulary hadn't been cleaned up entirely, and it took a while.
Understood.
And some of my bad habits. Let me say one thing, Pastor Jim. From the day I got off my knees, I can't explain this. This is supernatural. I never had another drink. I never had any more drugs. Any of that, it all immediately left me. Why, I don't know. But I still had some other battles to deal with.
Sure.
And so I attended First Baptist Church on the Hill under Dr. Clarence Sands, and it was a fantastic experience. But after a little over 2 years, I wanted to move to a smaller church, a Southern Right. Baptist church downtown on Delmas Avenue, where a lot of my friends were. And so Pastor Sands didn't want me to leave because he knew my background. Right. But he said, if you want to. So I moved to the Southern Baptist Church, and I was there for 4.5 years. The pastor there gave some of us younger guys opportunities in the evening to actually preach sermons.
Yes.
He would help us to develop our sermons.
Oh, good.
And so my first year there, I actually preached once or twice, and had a few opportunities there the 4.5 years I was there.
Right.
I taught junior hires while I was there, and also taught junior hires at First Baptist Church. But after a while, I no longer had the patience that you need to teach junior hires.
Yeah, that's a special skill for sure.
I had a good group of junior hires. In fact, one of the students at First Southern Baptist is now pastoring at Cry Out Christian Fellowship, not far from here.
Oh, right.
Arnold Perez.
Yes.
He's been pastoring for 28 years.
I know Arnold. Yeah.
And
what a coincidence.
Anyway, I went from a junior high class to teaching single adults. Right. And that's where I met my future wife. And we had a fantastic fellowship there.
Right.
And I also spent some time at my wife and I at Calvary Baptist in Los Gatos.
Okay.
And I got an invitation to come and help a pastor who had just graduated seminary, and he was starting a Christian fellowship using the facilities back up at First Baptist Church in their chapel. And so while remaining at Calvary Baptist for 1 year, in the afternoon, after getting out of Calvary Baptist in the morning, I would grab a quick meal and go to East Community Baptist. And I did that for 1 year, but it was taking a toll on me, right, being at Calvary morning and evening, yeah, and then being at East Community. So I decided to throw my lot in with East Community Baptist. And that's where I met Debbie Nitro, who's the secretary
here. Oh, of course, yeah.
And Debbie and her husband, Bob.
Right.
And our pastor left the church in 1983 due to some personal issues. And I was the associate pastor at the time.
Right.
And I became the senior pastor. Mind you, Pastor Jim, I had never been to Bible school, seminary. Right. Two of my pastors had discipled me in the faith.
Right.
And that was my education.
Sure. Well, there's absolutely nothing in Scripture that says you need to have any kind of formal training, right? God's going to use you in spite of you not having the formal training.
Yeah.
But that you love Jesus and you had a heart for the Lord, George. And that's, you know, you're going on, 48 years now of faithfully serving the Lord. Because it sounds like you were serving the Lord from day one. I mean, when you received Christ, it was not long at all, and you were serving him.
And that's due to my friend Rudy telling me, short of death, you're in the hospital or you're sick, every Sunday you're in church services.
Yep.
Or you're on vacation, something like that. You're always in the church services. And I really believe that believers harm themselves when they're not active faithfully in their local church.
Yeah. I would agree. Well, I can say that we are certainly we are privileged and blessed to have you as a member here at Blossom Valley Bible Church, George. Your character and your willingness to serve is an incredible inspiration for me. I certainly appreciate the support and the encouragement that you've given me over the last year, and especially over the last year, but I guess really since I first started here back in 2013. You've been so encouraging, and you're just a great role model for people, George. Your love of God is undeniable, you know, and you live and you breathe the word. And
thank you, Pastor Jim.
I'm proud to call you brother. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we hope that you enjoyed this little chat that we've had with Brother George Garcia. I hope that it's an encouragement for you. And we wanted to put it out there as kind of an early Christmas present, because next week it'll be 50 years since George got that surprise relief from the big house. and we are all grateful, and we all have benefited from it mightily. Well, thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time with the next installment of Blossom Valley Bible Church Live, or whatever we're going to call it. Wave bye, George. Ha 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 ha.